Hello, and welcome to Cabinet Conversations. My name is Paul Tatro, and I'm the director of Ford's Theater. If you're joining us for the first time, this is our live series exploring creativity, history, and leadership. You can learn more and explore our past programs by visiting our website at www.fords.org. During the 4 years of his presidency, Abraham Lincoln turned to humor to help him cope with the stresses of managing a country through the Civil War. Lincoln expressed his humanity, understanding, and his human foibles through humor. He used it for personal and political benefits. He also frequently attended comedies at Ford's Theater. And he was known for telling jokes, for his witty stories, and for his self-deprecation. The ability for a leader or a politician to laugh at oneself and at politics more broadly is a hallmark of our democracy. In humor, we not only have a release valve, but a way to call attention to ideological differences while still maintaining the bounds of democratic discourse. Today, in these polarized times, and as we head towards a presidential election, we bring together a panel known for their ability to laugh about the business of leadership and politics. I'm pleased to welcome our distinguished guest today. Long before Stephen Colbert and Jon Stewart, Mark Russell dared to joke and sing about the often absurd political process. Though he actually knew little about politics when he first began performing, Russell's ability to find humor in anything made him an immediate hit. His career spanned from a piano bar on Capitol Hill to 30 years worth of his Mark Russell comedy specials on public television and regular tours to theaters and college campuses. Until his retirement very recently, Mark performed annually at Ford's Theater, and we are delighted to have him join us. Thank you, Mark. Former Congressman Joe Crowley is a political consultant who provides strategic advice to clients on a wide range of public policy matters. He represented the 14th District of New York, including his hometown of Woodside, Queens, in the U.S. Congress for nearly 20 years. The former chairman of the Democratic Caucus is also known for his love of music and even the odd duet with Stephen Colbert at a famed Democratic retreat. Today's moderator is Gordon Peterson. Gordon is an award-winning news anchor, reporter, writer, and producer. For 25 years, he served as moderator and executive producer of the political roundtable Inside Washington, which was broadcast in Washington, D.C., and many other major television markets from coast to coast. By the time he retired, Peterson had also covered local news in the nation's capital for 50 years. We're excited to have this D.C. legend with us today. Now, as a reminder to all our viewers, we're taking your questions on our social media platforms. Please feel free to submit those so that we may share your questions with our guests during the program. Now, it's my pleasure to introduce and give this panel over to Gordon Peterson. Take it away, and y'all have a great time.
Thank you, Paul. Hello, Mark. Hello, Joe.
Hi.
May I call you Joe?
You certainly may.
Remember that? Sarah Palin, Joe Biden. She was afraid she's going to call old Biden.
My mother calls me Joseph. As long as you don't call me Joseph, I'm okay. So.
You know, I've always believed that our ability to laugh at ourselves has played a major role in keeping the American experiment and democracy alive. I know you agree with me. About 4 years ago, GQ published a list of America's wittiest presidents. Abraham Lincoln, of course, number one at the top of the list. No surprise there. Millard Fillmore, yeah, number 44, sad to say. Jimmy Carter, number 28. Ronald Reagan, the sixth wittiest president, right behind, you guessed it, Calvin Coolidge. Hey, Abraham Lincoln said it was better to remain silent and be thought a fool than to speak up and remove all doubt. That's my cue to stop talking. Now, regarding our contemporary politics, for the past few years, I've been hearing the same phrase over and over, namely, you can't make this stuff up. Mark, do you find the wild realities of contemporary American politics are making your job more difficult?
Yeah, it has been it's always been easy. When I first was aware of Abraham Lincoln, I was just a little kid, and I have this child's book, illustrated book about Lincoln, and it showed he and his cousin in their bare feet were walking around outside in the mud, and then they went inside, and Lincoln picked up his cousin, held him upside down, and left muddy footprints on the ceiling. Now, did that happen? Who cares? But it was believable. I mean, there was no, you can't imagine Calvin Coolidge upside down like that. Now, some people thought that Lincoln's jokes were dirty. They weren't dirty, they were earthy. For example, he and a bunch of guys were talking about the Revolutionary War, and Lincoln said what the American colonists should have done was to put pictures of George Washington in all of the British privies, because nothing scares the shit out of an Englishman more than General Washington. Earthy, right? And before Lincoln became president, a man from Virginia challenged him to a duel. And Lincoln responded, he said, "I accept your challenge, sir, as long as I pick the weapons and the distance at which we stand. Cow manure at 5 paces. Earthy."
Lincoln was, Joe, as you know, Lincoln was a genius in self-deprecating humor. A lot of that stemmed from his hardscrabble upbringing and his appearance, which he was always sensitive about. Remember, he said, "If I had 2 faces, you think I'd be wearing this one?" But in my experience, there aren't that many politicians out there willing to laugh at their own expense. Am I right?
I think that's probably true. I think you see it particularly nowadays more than ever, whether it's about their weight or their dress or how they comport themselves, people are less likely to do that. We saw Paul Simon, the former senator, was very self-deprecating. I think was a good example of it. And we've had others throughout even modern history have been more self-deprecating. I've always taken myself lightly, I think. Mark had mentioned, I've been a great fan of Abraham Lincoln. Before I knew I was a Democrat, you know, and he was a Republican, I loved him as a boy, the old black and white movies. But, you know, Mark, unlike you and Gordon, I didn't actually know Abraham Lincoln. But I always felt that he knew me. I felt the spirit with him that has been used a lot. But I'm a Lincoln-file because of that. And it's because of that humor that was portrayed in many of those old black and white movies that went back. And even, and Mark, you know, the ad that you just used was featured in the film about Lincoln. That I thought was also very appropriate. It did show that earthiness, but it was also about that self-deprecation, about not being able to take on his lankiness or his gangliness, I think was maybe, you know, he actually said, Gordon, this goes to your point, after 40, every man gets the face he deserves. And no president was really, really defined more by their face, by their nose, by their chin and their hair on their face, you know, that top hat, than Abraham Lincoln. And he used that, I think, greatly to his advantage politically.
Well, he went along with it. I mean, he was portrayed as a gangly, ugly baboon, a P.T. Barnum figure. Barnum had this museum. It was before the circus, and it featured oddities and weird people. And they called Lincoln a P.T. Barnum baboon. He went along with it until his own Secretary of War, Stanton, joined in the ridicule. He didn't like that. It kind of reminds you of a certain president we won't mention, whose own Secretary of State, Rex Tillerson, called him a moron, or effing moron, to be specific.
Lincoln's opponent in those famous Lincoln-Douglas debates, Stephen A. Douglas, said that when he debated Lincoln, he'd be doing very well. And then Lincoln would tell a joke. He said it'd be like a slap in the back. And it would just totally disarm him. And he always knew he was going to lose. In one debate, Lincoln said to him, your argument is as thin as the soup was made by boiling the shadow of a pigeon that had starved to death. Back from that on a serious issue. It's pretty tough. You know, I can't think of a better asset, though, in politics than the ability to get a laugh out of your audience, especially in a tough campaign. Am I right?
Yeah, I think it can be very disarming. It can, you know, when you're in a debate, whether it's running for a local office, a school board, and you're trying to get that attention or that moment, that spark, it's often done by a quip or self-deprecating kind of humor that people just breaks the ice and breaks the tension sometimes, and allows you to be even more thoughtful and clear in thought, and you kind of use the balance of the joke, but at the same time, you then turn to being serious, and I think that actually draws more attention to your thought, to your ability to think on your feet. That gets respect, quite frankly. And, you know, not to pick on anyone in particular, but, you know, you have to have empathy to be humorous. You have to have sympathy for others. You know, it's not funny when you just pick on someone and point out their disability or point out their weakness. Yeah. It's actually funnier when you point it out about yourself, and then are able to, you know, even use the weakness of an argument as as thin a soup, you know, based on a pigeon that's been starved. You know, there's nothing there, but you can read through that. And that's something that the most uneducated person could understand as well. And you can kind of break through that way.
Well, self-deprecation is my least favorite form of humor, I got to tell you. But you have to know where to put the joke. Ronald Reagan knew that his age was going to be brought up in his debate with Walter Mondale. And so he knew. He had that at the ready. He says, I will not take advantage of my opponent's youth and inexperience. But the debate with Douglas, he said, he can compress the most words into the smallest ideas better than any man I ever met.
You know, sometimes it helps to run right at the issue they're attacking you for. For example, some of us are older enough to remember the 1960 Jack Kennedy campaign. And the allegation was that his father, Joe Kennedy, was buying boats, primary boats in West Virginia from deputy sheriffs and so forth. So Jack Kennedy goes to the gridiron dinner, and he pretends to have a telegram from his father, from the old man. He says, "Dear Jack, don't buy one more boat than necessary. I'll be damned if I'll pay for a landslide." Now, he owned the crowd.
You know, there's
absolutely.
There's a 100-year-old joke that still gets a laugh, even from older people who are very familiar with the joke. And that's when Will Rogers said, "I belong to no organized political party. I'm a Democrat." I'm a Democrat. And that always gets a laugh, even among people, because it's clever, it's a wordplay, and it's perfect.
Let me go back to something to which Joe just alluded. Lincoln had a very, very sharp humor, but he was an extremely kindly man. He was not a mean human being. What's off limits for you in political humor, Joe, as a politician?
Well, you know, there's also there's been some reporting about Lincoln as well. In his earlier days, he wasn't maybe as nice as he was in his more senior days. And so, you know, that he was a pretty cutthroat politician at some points as well. But I think that life experience, all that he had gone through and all that he had seen, I think, you know, was the richness of those experiences that gave him that fluency of experience that that added to the value of that storytelling that he did. Look, I mean, I still think that off-color jokes, and that it's not the earthiness. Earthy's fine. I think the closer you can be to earthy without maybe going over the line, even the better. Using wit, having a wit, and not just a joke. I mean, someone telling a joke without wit, it falls very flat, or as Mark mentioned, the timing thereof. There has to be a wittiness about that. And I think that's what you look for. But I think, you know, making fun of someone's disability or making fun of someone else and their disability or making fun a disaster, you know, can be very, very, it could fall flat very easily. And I think that's what we have to be careful of. Just, first of all, not having people understand what you're trying to get at, you know, It's got to be meaningful. It just can't be said for the sake of saying it.
Hey, Mark, is there a line you don't dare cross? I mean, you walk up and you just don't step over. How do you? It takes a special gift to know where that line is, I would think.
Yeah, the line keeps changing. And I think today you got to say there's no line. When you get a situation in current politics where the straw is broken. Wow, he broke the straw and that was it. That's it. And today it's all the old rules, as far as I'm concerned, don't apply. One of the most quoted lines of Lincoln, they say, how can you come home from the battle with all the bloodshed and tell jokes? And then Lincoln said, I tell jokes. If I did not tell jokes, I would cry. Some say I would die and like that. Well, I was in a situation like that a few years ago at the White House Correspondents' Dinner. I was brought in to tell jokes and stuff. But as it turned out, President and Mrs. Reagan were there. And it was a very, very sad day because they had just returned from Delaware to receive the bodies of the Americans that had been blown up by a terrorist attack over in Nairobi. So Reagan is introduced and he gets up there and he says, well, this is not a night for jokes. Mark Russell's good at that. He's better at that than I am. And my stomach starts churning. And he said, this is not a night for levity and like that. And then I'm introduced and I proceed. What I should have done was, I agree with the president and then sat down. But when I proceeded with my jokes and levity and satire, and I bombed like a B-29 over Hiroshima. It just did. And I was thinking, well, why did the Reagans even show up if he's going to do that? But I mean, Lincoln was better. I'm no Lincoln. Lincoln was a friend of mine, and I'm no Abraham Lincoln.
right, man. You know, Lincoln said a hearty laugh relieves you, but that anticipated the question. I mean, we're in the middle of a pandemic. You know, the horrors of 9/11. I mean, how do you fire up after a tragic event like that? It's pretty tough.
Well, I think you have to keep in mind, though, too, that Lincoln himself lived to the most traumatic period in our history as a country, as a nation. You know, the attempt to break up the Union, the Civil War, based on slavery. I mean, and life was much more difficult back in those days. I mean, you know, in terms of survival itself, there wasn't a McDonald's on every block or a Starbucks on every block in those days, you know. So, you know, self-survival was different. But, you know, and this goes more maybe to the point in terms of it's not so much humor, but using wit that Lincoln did in terms of slavery when he said, whenever I hear anyone arguing for slavery, I feel a strong impulse to see it tried on him personally. You know, it spoke directly to that issue as to what the immorality of it was without having to go through a long dissertation about it. And so, you know, the times are tough today, and I recognize that. And I always say that, but it's not as bad as the Civil War. It's not as bad as, you know, even with pandemic and everything else going on, over a million people killing each other. We're not at that point. Hopefully never back there again.
I think we're getting close.
Well, yeah, I pray not.
Yeah, you know, talked about keeping the country together. General George Meade, the Union general at Gettysburg, who defeated Robert E. Lee, and he sends a wire to Lincoln, I have saved the Union soil. Say, well, Lincoln didn't like that. He says, well, there's no Union soil. It's all American soil. It's like when Barack Obama said there are no red states and no blue states, just United States. And that's what Lincoln was getting at.
Well, I'm glad you brought that up because I was going to mention it. I've been to so many of your shows where you have a little something to offend everybody.
Yes.
Yet you managed to get everybody laughing together, and it's a great gift. It's a tightrope. But that song, which my wife Ann thinks is one of the greatest of yours, My State's Red, Your State's Blue. I mean, it's a great closer for you. Can you talk about that a little bit?
No. because I can't remember it. It was to the tune, "Your land, this land is my land, this land is your land." Yeah, that was fun to do. I wish I could deliver on it, but it's yeah, that was, I didn't always succeed at that. I'd upset people, and I'd say, well, if you don't like if you don't like Nixon now, just wait around and the pendulum will swing again. And that was it. The pendulum always swings, and I just go with that. The humor, usually it tilts toward the president. I mean, you can't stand up there with a, with a, with a scale and weigh one joke against another. But it, I find that that the business community, the corporate community, they have thinner skins than the politicians. They really do. Even though they're unelected, and I used to have a little game that I would play if I was doing a show for a corporation, right? And I hadn't gone on yet, and I'm sitting next to the CEO of the corporation, and I would say to him, listen, before I go on, I want you to know that I'm not going to say anything about the lawsuit. And in every case, they always say, hey, thanks a lot. I appreciate it. And I don't know if there's a lawsuit or not. There's always a lawsuit.
Joe, when you're on the campaign trail, and I don't see how you run for office in New York unless you have a great sense of humor. Like that. You're on the campaign trail. You're using your best stuff. And you're like Mark in the, you know, making a speech in Cleveland to the paper manufacturer, and everything he says gets blank stares. How do you recover when you throw up your best stuff and you get nothing back?
Well, you know, I think part of it is just going with the flow. And mine was more not about, you know, prepared joke telling. It's really more about sizing up the room, sizing up the atmosphere, what's happening, and you know, just trying to find a way that you can kind of connect and make. And I think part of that is not necessarily, it's part of the sense of humor aspect of it, not about joke telling per se or storytelling, but about using wit as a way to kind of break through. You know, for me, and I will say this as a lifelong fan of Marx, I remember as a boy, you know, watching when there was limited television, unfortunately, sorry, Mark, but
it had just been a day.
But, you know, but being sitting there with my parents and being forced to watch PBS, with all kidding aside, but I loved watching Mark Russell and listening to it and the music. It was about, and the funniness, and I didn't get all the jokes all the time or understand it, but it was part of my political awakening as well, and understanding of politics and of history. And as a musician, as someone who loves music as well, I certainly have used music in my life in a political way. My being comfortable in the use of a microphone, having sung at weddings, and, you know, having drunk people in front of you, you kind of understand. If you develop, a self defense to some degree. And Mark probably knows all about that as well. I think there's, it's great power being in those positions of being the focus of attention, and having that wit, I think, helps you get through it. I think Lincoln had that same experience. Had to have.
And you're both musicians, which has to give you an extra edge, I think, in both disciplines. I mean,
well, I only know three chords, and somebody once said an evening with Mark Russell is an evening of polka music. You know, that was Lincoln used to heckle his own cabinet. One time he said, "Everybody in favor of the emancipation of the slaves, raise your right hand." And nobody raised their hand. And then Lincoln raised his right hand and said, "The ayes have it." And then somebody said, "How come your Attorney General Bates's beard is pure white and the hair on his head is black? Why is that?" He says, "Because Bates only uses his jaw instead of his brain."
What's the other thing he said about slavery, among other things? He said, "Whenever I hear anybody arguing for slavery, I feel a strong impulse to see it tried on him personally.
You say it's all about the delivery. I said that before, Mark didn't laugh. You said it, he found it funny. So it's like, it's all about timing and delivery, Gordon.
Who are your favorite humorists or comedians or political satirists over the years? I'm going a little far afield, but we have.
Well, if you want to know what, and I anticipated the question as opposed to the song from, those of us who remember, first of all, the hearings going on today are deadly serious, deadly devoid of humor. And over the years, Robert Bork and Clarence Thomas and the current nominee for the Supreme Court, Brett Kavanaugh, no comedy relief. And yet you go back to the equally deadly serious Watergate hearings. You had the folksy Senator Sam Ervin of North Carolina, and he knew where to drop in a folksy country lawyer. When he said, "I'm just a plain country lawyer," you knew there was going to be some comedy relief. And that was, in my opinion, Lincoln-esque. And Lincoln always comes to mind when I hear former Senator Alan Simpson of Wyoming. You go to his eulogy of President George H.W. Bush. Here he is at a funeral getting huge laughs. It was perfect. And then you have Senator Daniel Patrick Moynihan, who was not rural. He was sophisticated. They were all sophisticated. Lincoln had practically no school at all. He could quote Shakespeare. But Moynihan spoke at a roast of the Washington Post, Ben Bradley, and you get a hold of that. And to me, that was Lincoln-esque. And then you had Molly Ivins with her Texas humor, and Garrison Keillor with his Minnesota Lutheran humor. And I say this with a straight face. I mean, his Lake Wobegon stories are mindful of Mark Twain, there's no question about it. So they've been around, and these are not stand-up comedians, they're not late-night people, but they had a natural sense of folksy humor.
Well, in Congress, who was the most fun to work with?
Most fun to work with in Congress? My gosh, I was there for 20 years. There were a lot of fun. I think, you know, interestingly enough, Mark Udall, out of Colorado. You know, his father was Mo Udall, who was, I didn't work with Mo, but I was legendary. And I found Mark Udall and his cousin Tom, they both have great senses of humor. Fantastic. Ed Perlmutter today, out in Colorado, has a great sense of humor. I think those are the kind of folks that I'm attracted to. You know, in terms of my own looking back, I had a little bit, you know, a little different experience in the sense that I think of the music of the 70s, of the Nixon era in particular, and maybe even before that, but like Tom Paxson and the Chad Mitchell Trio or the Kingston Trio, your friendly neighborhood Ku Klux Klan, the Ballad of Spiro Agnew, all those kind of songs I was attracted to as a kid for some reason. But Saturday Night Live, the start in the mid 70s, and how they approach things in a very, you know, a very very controversial way in many respects. I think I heard recently Ethan Hawke, the actor, talking about the influence of Richard Pryor, Eddie Murphy, and Chris Rock, for instance, as being responsible for him learning about racism. You know, but it was all done through humor, and I think I also had that experience as well. So. It's, you know, Minnie Pearl, though, you know, from Hee Haw and from the Grand Ole Opry. I love to watch her, too. And I thought as a kid, we just thought she was hysterical. But she also kind of from time to time pushed the envelope in her own little way.
I knew Mo Udall and I know his son, too. But I think Mo coined two jokes I never heard from anybody else were two inmates in a federal penitentiary were in the mess hall. And one turned the other one. He says, "You know, the food was better here when you were governor."
You know, You alluded to this earlier, Mark, but humor does change over the years. I mean, there's stuff you couldn't get away with 30 years ago. You'd get away with now.
Yeah, that's why there were, I guess there was a line you dare not cross. Lincoln got some of the material from, they took from joke books, from Artemus Ward, who was the humorist of his day. Artemus Ward was said to be Mark Twain's favorite humorist. And you look at some of these joke books and you say, well, it was, you had to be there. That was it. You had to be there. There's a scene in one of those black and white movies that Joe mentioned. It was on recently. Abe Lincoln in Illinois, and he just met the woman he was going to marry, Mary Todd. And he said, well, the Todds are pretty pretty fancy people. They spelled Todd with two D's. That's pretty highfalutin when you consider there's only one D in dog. And so there's one. And knowing that we were going to be doing this in a few days, I'm looking at the movie on Turner Classic, and he's in the corner telling jokes to all men, right? And I'm thinking, let me hear what he's going to say so I can use it. And all you do is hear the men laughing, and then Mary tries to butt in. Well, now, Mary, you just run along now. We're just talking politics. So it was like that. In our memory, after a dinner party, the men would go off to one room and smoke their cigars and tell their jokes, and the women would go to another room and talk about their grandchildren. Well, that's over with. So. But there were more lines. There were more lines to cross. I would imitate a politician and say, "Well, Senator, are you pro-life?" "Yeah, I sure am." "Are you pro-choice?" He says, "You bet."
You know, I think some of these great comics not only open up our minds, but they open up our hearts. And over the years, when I think about, you know, Lenny Bruce or Dick Gregory or Mort Saul or Smothers Brothers, George Carlin, I think they've had a tremendous impact on our society and our ability to just get along with each other. Although it's hard to see that during this current campaign, but it's still there, I think.
But I wasn't allowed to listen to George Carlin as a kid, which maybe would have listened to him more. You know, it's like the people your parents try to shield you from, I'm more interested in hearing about what they have to say. But Gordon, I also think, though, for instance, Lincoln was a great fan of all things Shakespeare, you know, right? I can't say I am, you know, but there was humor that was in Shakespeare that they were able to laugh at back then. There were jokes that or things that Lincoln alluded to that would have to take a little bit more, you know, learning a little depth into finding out what he was actually talking about. So, and yeah, so you know, things that worked in the 1800s, 1860s may not work in the, you know, the 21st century, but the basis is still there. And I think some things we've actually just repeated ourselves, we can still all find humor or all find wit in those adages. And I think that's what's remained true. But the one thing that Lincoln comes to about Lincoln, whether it's in black and white movies or new movies or the books we read, is that he definitely understood the power of wit, understood the power of humor, and it was innate. It was something he was born with. He developed it naturally over time, and it wore on him and wore on him well.
You know, when I first got into the news business, I mean, we had three networks, news operations. We had New York Times, Washington Post, big newspapers. Now newspapers are dying. We've got cable news, and we've got social media. I mean, how has social media changed the way we confront some of the most ridiculous issues of our day? Because on the one hand, you have the internet, which all kinds of whacked out stuff is going on there. Anybody with a little laptop can propound the most absurd conspiracy theories, and it'll go viral.
Yeah, go ahead.
Well, all of that stuff scares the hell out of me and makes me grateful that I'm retired. I mean, when you have social media, you get a heckler immediately. If you would go on a radio, there would be an 8-second delay. But when you were, for example, I used to do Larry King a lot when he was just on radio, and it was live, and it was midnight to 3 a.m, which is when they all come out of the woodwork and they're listening to the radio and they're calling Larry King, and you get the stuff that's blipped out, the disgusting, and it throws you. It really does throw you, you know. Hey, Russell, I'm gonna cut you, cut your heart out and then feed it to the crows or worse. And so now you can't blip anything out. You can't censor anything. And
it has changed our lives in a significant way.
No doubt. Yeah.
Blessing and a curse, I guess.
But I also think that, I think personally speaking, I'm looking for some relief from, you know, expecting to hear the latest tweet. Quite frankly, I'd like to go back to a day where I didn't have to worry about what the last thing the President of the United States had to say. Let a day go by or two or three without having to worry about that, from my personal vantage point. But, you know, I also know, in terms of my iPhone or, you know, my accounts, you know, people are sending memes or they're sending, you know, little quips to me all the time in a joking way. So, you know, humor is the new medium is also being used for sending those little jokes along the way or those little cartoons that we're all seeing. And it's as witty or as funny, maybe even more omnipresent, omnipotent now than ever before.
You mentioned George Carlin.
We've got Photoshop, so anybody can be a cartoonist now.
Absolutely, yeah.
You mentioned George Carlin. I have to be
a political cartoonist in a newspaper.
Mm-hmm. Go ahead, Mark, what did you say?
You mentioned George Carlin. I have to put in a plug for the National Comedy Center up in Jamestown, New York, which is just south of Buffalo. And it they cover everything, even from Aristophanes and Lysistrata, which was an ancient Greek play about all the women in the village wanted to stop their husbands from waging war, so they withheld their sexual favors from them. And it's all covered right up to George Carlin and Lenny Bruce. And it's a brilliant, it's like a Smithsonian of comedy. And then they have the blue room, as in blue humor. You have to be 18 years of age, and you walk in there, and there, in foot and a half size letters all over the room on four walls, are George Carlin's 7 words you can't say on television. They have Lenny Bruce's raincoat that he would wear on stage in case he was arrested, so he could just. I have a raincoat to wear to the police department. And so it's quite a place if you're interested in comedy.
Who are your favorite women performers? Wanda Sykes, Joan Rivers, anybody else you can think of?
I love Jane Curtin. I thought she was great and very funny. Rosie O'Donnell, I think, has a great wit and is funny as well. I know the president doesn't have much respect for her, but I do. I think some of the present players on SNL are great. Maya Rudolph and others, they're just fantastic. And their political acumen is up there as well. In order to perform and do it well, you have to have some real sense of who the characters are, what their stances are to pull it off. So
Lily Tomlin. Now, Lily Tomlin got the Mark Twain Award, the Kennedy Center, a few years ago. And she accepted the award, and on a little pedestal next to her is a bust of Mark Twain. And she looks down at the bust of Mark Twain, and she says, Mark Twain and I have two things in common. She says, we're both funny, and I'm starting to grow a mustache. She's my favorite female friend. And Maya Rudolph, I'll tell you, before she was very well known, she did a routine of the national anthem being butchered at a sporting event, and as is done often, and it is hilarious, just hilarious.
I always loved Elaine May. I thought she was great.
Oh, wow. Yeah.
Let me ask you, Mark. My mind is taking me back to the Marquee Lounge at the Shoreham Hotel. And I would go over there after doing the late news and catch your last show. What were some of the best nights you ever had there?
Well, first of all, the first show was at 10:30 at night. And I mean, I'm in bed at that hour now, but it was 10:30. It was the lounge of the hotel. There was a bigger room, which was kind of like main big name acts, the Blue Room, big name acts. And then that show would be over with and the people would come out. And that's when I would kick off the first show at 10:30. And so we didn't have a cover charge, we didn't have a minimum, and they weren't all in there to just dote on every pearl of wisdom that I was hanging on. But we would have members of Congress come in there. And I would tell the audience that because Senator so-and-so is here, he's clean. He's unindicted. Otherwise, he would not be here. And sometimes that would not be the case. Mo Udall would come in there. Tip O'Neill would come in there. And both sides of the aisle. And Nixon people would come in there. Lyndon Johnson's people, Linda Bird Johnson would come in there, and she would sit in the back. I wouldn't know she was in the audience. And the same with the Nixon girls. They would come in there and they would sit in the back. And then years later, I would find out that they were there. So it was always a lot of fun. Adam Clayton Powell, the congressman from Harlem. He would be in there, and he came in there with two beautiful women. He's sitting right up front, and I'm joking about Powell, and people didn't know he was sitting there. They said, yeah, that Powell, that rascal. And so it was a lot of fun. It would get wild, and because it was so late, but I was there for 20 years.
Years. Yeah. Joe, one of the things I noticed a couple of years ago up on the hill when I walked by the house dining room, it was kind of empty. Years ago, you'd go by the house dining room, there'd be Republicans, Democrats sitting together, having lunch, having a great time. We seem to have lost some of that.
Well, I think there's a lot of reason for that. I think... first of all, there's more that takes place than maybe you know, and it may not be happening in the dining room. A lot of people complain about the food all the time. You know, it's one of the reasons why they want to be there. I actually always enjoyed being there. I thought it was a great place to dine with folks and to really experience the full experience of the Capitol. I think it was Tip O'Neill said the jet airplane killed Congress. You know, people just aren't in D.C. as much anymore. When they're done with the day, they can be back in their districts. You know, for New Yorkers, we can be on a shuttle every half hour back to New York City. And I think the expectation was that you'd be back more at home. And I think that's also hurt. You know, there are a number of issues that we don't have enough time to go into today. But what I would say to you, my experience has been, though, too, regardless of political party, I'm always attracted to people who have that wit, have that humor, have that self-confidence about them that I think that provides. You have to be self-confident to have wit and have humor, I think. And those are the folks that I was, the people who are dry stuck up push away, I was never attracted to. And both sides of the aisle, a great friend of mine today, Billy Schuster, I have a great relationship with. John Boehner, I have a great relationship with, because they don't take themselves too seriously. And I think as Democrats and Republicans, that's a good example.
Yeah, I mean, remember Tip O'Neill and Bob Michael would be having a battle on the floor of the House, and they play cards that night. Yeah. And, I'm glad to hear that some of that is still going on, because I think that's pretty much the way this thing's supposed to work.
Yeah, not nearly as much as it should, but some still happens.
Well, I'll tell you, Mark, when you think back over the past several years, which of the political comedians do you think have been the most influential in terms of the way Americans approach their government and how they feel about the way the country's being run?
Well, for one thing, if this election turns out in a certain way, it will be, how do I put this? If it turns out the way that the three of us don't want it to turn out, without mentioning names, that will render political humor totally ineffectual. These guys late at night haven't put a dent in our current president. They really haven't. As far as it used to be, whoever made it into the nightly monologue, in other words, his transgressions became immediately known, and Johnny Carson's writers and Jay Leno's writers would make the decision, yeah, the public will get this. If your name winds up in that monologue, you're finished. And so if the name winds up in the monologue 5 nights a week for 4 years, you'd think you would be finished. But I don't know if anybody ever made a difference as far as comedy. It just lightened things up, that's all. Like, as I said, during these hearings, for example. The immediate thing, in other words, you get up there, you know, and you say, well, I'm going to change the world, and I want this guy to lose, and I want this guy to win. No, you're just worried about the next laugh. It's just incremental. Do I get a laugh? Get a laugh like that. And I was always interested and impressed by the fact that in the Civil War, you had children in that war. You had teenagers in that war. You had old men fighting. And impressed by that, after 9/11, I tried to re-enlist in the Marine Corps. As you know, Gordon, you and I were Marines, and they humored me. They gave me the physical, and they made me fill out the form, get permission from my mother. And they said, okay, we classify you 14F. I said, 14F? What's that? They said, well, when the enemy is at the corner of 14th and F, we'll take you. Now, did that happen? No. But you don't care. That's the thing. And it goes back to Lincoln with holding his cousin up. Did it happen? No. But it's possible. It could have happened.
Yeah. You you think of the Smothers Brothers, CBS killing the Smothers Brothers show, and compared to what goes on the air today or on the internet, social media, pretty wild stuff. I mean, it's just astonishing that would happen. It just wouldn't happen today, I guess.
Well, they were taken off the air by CBS and replaced by Glenn Campbell, and they were full against the war, and they're very effective, and so they're retired now, but they did do a special show up at Chautauqua a couple of years ago. And so they threw in some zingers there, and but right now there's not enough of it. There is enough in terms of every night, but it's just too much. The straw is broken every night. Did I answer the question? I don't know that I did.
You did. I just want to wait. One thing about Abe Lincoln. He had only about a year of formal education, but even so, he was more literate than most of the adults around him, including his father, Thomas, who was a great storyteller himself, apparently. He loved to read, and although there weren't many books available to him, he read everything he put his hands on. But somewhere in his preteens, between the ages of like 12 and 11 and 13 and something, he wrote a poem that gives us a clue to his quirky humor. Abraham Lincoln, his hand and pen, he will be good, but God knows when. Abraham Lincoln is my name, and with my pen I wrote the same. I wrote it in both haste and speed, and left it here for fools to read. This fool just read it.
Well, let me correct the record here for one thing. Abraham Lincoln at the Gettysburg Address, it was not fully received favorably. A Chicago newspaper said it was dull and drab and childish and dishwatery, and that's compared to another Chicago paper, the Chicago Tribune, who said after the 1948 campaign between Harry Truman and Thomas E. Dewey, said, Dewey wins. So there's so much for Chicago journalism. But Lincoln, remember, he followed a speaker that day who spoke for 2 hours, Edward Everett, the most prominent orator of the day. Some say, no, 1 hour, 2 hours, but he spoke all that time. So Lincoln opened his address by saying, ladies and gentlemen, it seems like 47 years ago when Everett started that speech. And then people say, well, what would Lincoln say if he was here today? I think if Lincoln was here today, he would say, wow, I can't believe that I'm 211 years old. Now, don't fact check it. He was born in 1809. I can hear the millennials fact checking now. Wait a minute. 11 years old.
It's been great chatting with you, Joe Crowley and Mark.
Thanks, Gordon.
So much. It's been a lot of fun.
Thanks,
Thank
Mark.
You, guys.
Thanks, Gordon.
Thank you.
Take care. All the best. Vote early and vote often.
Wow. My face is hurting from laughing. This has been, you know, a great hour with you gentlemen. And, you know, I like one of my favorite lines is from the great Thornton Wilder, who said 99% of the people in the world are fools and the rest of us are in great danger of contagion. I think about that every day. I want to thank Joe Crowley, Mark Russell, and Gordon Peterson. And thanks to all of you for watching. We'll continue to respond to your Facebook and Twitter comments and questions that we didn't get to during the live session today. All joking aside, Ford's Theater believes in the power of civic engagement. We encourage you and your family and friends and neighbors to make a plan and vote. If you would like more voting resources, please visit vote.org and take your civic duty to heart. If you enjoyed today's cabinet conversations, consider making a gift to help support the mission and work of Ford's Theater. You can do so at fords.org/donate. Please join us for our next cabinet conversation on November 5th, when I'm sure we'll discuss in great detail all of the outcome of the election. Gentlemen, thank you for a great and humor-filled afternoon. I really appreciate it. Good afternoon to all. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Paul.
Thank you. Paul. Bye-bye.